season. But we're going to be closing up today the story of Solomon. Solomon, for those that have not been with us, was the son of David. He was the king of Israel. And at the beginning of his reign, a couple of things happened. One thing was that his father, the king at the time, pronounced a blessing and a charge over Solomon that was very important. And essentially, it was to say that Solomon, if you want the blessing of God, if you want success, if you want to find favor in your kingdom, in your leadership, in your life, you need to follow the law of God, walk in the word of God, and walk in the presence of God. Be close to me, both in your actions and your heart, and then I will bless everything you do. Following that blessing, a powerful thing takes place in that God, through a dream, visits Solomon. And he's given Solomon the question, okay, Solomon, you can pick from anything you want. What is it you want? And I'll answer it. I will answer any prayer that you give me. And Solomon, with just a sense of wisdom about him, says to the Lord, listen, more than anything else, I want understanding. I want the ability to make wise and right choices, to know how to discern between true and false, right and wrong, wise and unwise. And God says, man, you chose wisely. You chose the right thing. And because you chose that, all the things that you could have asked for, I mean, you could have asked for wealth, and you could have asked for power, and you could have asked for fame, and you could have asked for your enemies to be destroyed. You could have asked for all those things. But because you didn't ask for that and said you asked for something better, I'm going to give you all those other things. And certainly we see that in the pages of 1 Kings. Because what takes place up to this point is just incredible. I mean, Solomon, through wisdom, gains influence in the region. I mean, he gains influence with all the governmental leaders, all the kings and queens, all the foreign dispatches that come through. He establishes a solid economy in Israel. He establishes safe borders in Israel. There's an educational system. I mean, there's all kinds of things. And last week, we talked about one of the keystones of Solomon's tenure as king was that he constructed the temple of God. Prior to that time, the presence of God was held in the tabernacle, the tent of meeting, but it was on David's heart and then on Solomon's heart that God would have a home, would be the centerpiece of the nation. And through years of construction and probably the equivalent of billions of dollars in our modern economy, Solomon constructs the temple of God, and God blesses that by filling that place with his presence. I mean, in dramatic fashion, if you were with us last week, you know that, I mean, pillar of cloud, fire, you know, the presence of God is so rich and so tangible that they can't even physically bring themselves on their feet. They're just laying before the Lord. I mean, it's just powerful demonstration. I mean, just tremendous blessing is on the nation of Israel through the leadership of Solomon. And incredible things. People are starting to take notice of what's happening. And he's on this dramatic high. I mean, if you would have been in the place where he's at in his life, I mean, he's on this tremendous high, right? I mean, some of you experienced this a little bit yesterday with the Ohio State game, where you just after the game, you're like, whoo, baby, I can do anything right now. I mean, we're at the top of our life, or the pinnacle of our life, right? And Solomon's there. And in that context, God yet again comes to Solomon. And he offers Solomon not an attaboy, not a way to go, not good job on building that temple. He offers to Solomon a warning, a reminder. Seems like a really weird place to offer that. I mean, everything is going right for Solomon. But he says to Solomon the same thing that his father, David, had said to him and that Solomon had heard from him when he had met with him the first time. He says, listen, Solomon, if you want success, if you want my blessing, if you want all the things in your life to be going in the right direction, you need to pay attention. You need to follow my law. You need to follow my words. Keep close to my scripture. Keep close to what we would call the Bible. Keep close to that. And be in my presence. Following that, lots of great things are written down. You can read them this week. Lots of great things are written down. I mean, there's this queen that comes in, the Queen of Sheba, and she comes in and says, listen, I want to see for myself. Everybody's been telling me how smart you are, and everybody's been telling me how wealthy you are, and how powerful you are, and how awesome you are. And I mean, she's just really buttering the bread. I mean, she's really putting it on thick. And Solomon, man, he's just hook, line, and sinker. I mean, he believes all of his own press. I mean, he's just, yeah, I am pretty awesome, aren't I? I mean, I'm pretty cool. Why don't you just take a look in my treasury room, and why don't you take whatever you want? You walk home, and I'm going to give you the swag bag on your way out. I mean, it's going to be awesome, right? I mean, he's really, and then the writer, the historian who's recounting this whole thing, talks about Solomon's wealth and how he's more wealthy than any in the known world. I mean, he is Bill Gates of his own world. I mean, there is nothing. But what we're going to see here today, despite being on the top of his world, at the top of his game, I mean, it seems like everything is going right. We're going to see the dramatic turn today. We're going to see the shift that will seem so surprising, given all of the things that are going right. How could it go so wrong? How could it go so poorly? We're going to be in 1 Kings chapter 11. 1 Kings chapter 11, if you have a Bible this morning, we'll be in verse 1. If you don't, then you can look behind me on the screen, or you can follow along in our app. We've got it listed there that you can follow along. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse 1 says, now Solomon loved many foreign women. One of the funniest phrases I think I've read in the Bible in a long time. Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh. Now, if you remember, back several weeks ago, the daughter of Pharaoh was his first foreign marriage. Now, this is not illegal for him to marry someone from Egypt. But what follows is the Moabite, Ammonite, the Edomite, Sidonian, and the Hittite women. From the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the people of Israel, you shall not enter into marriage with them. Neither shall they with you, for surely they will turn away your heart after their gods. Listen, Solomon, if you get into this relationship, this isn't just for you, this is for everybody in Israel. You get into relationships with these people, these women, if you get into these marriages, you can be sure, you can count it as solid information that your heart will turn away from me into the service and the worship of other gods. Solomon clung to these in love. He had 700 wives. For being the wisest man on the earth, doesn't seem like, you know, I'm going to stop there. 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. It makes that first sentence seem a little bit ridiculous. He loved many foreign women. Yeah, you want to say, right? And his wives turned his heart away. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not wholly true to the Lord, his God, as was the heart of his father David. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. So Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and did not follow wholly the Lord, as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place, a place of worship. He built an altar, a mini temple. After just building the temple of God and seeing fire and cloud, he builds the high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab. And for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites on the mountain east of Jerusalem. And so he did for all his foreign wives who made offerings and sacrifice to their gods. The writer here says that those that were mentioned just now are just some of the places and gods that Solomon sets up places of worship for, the high places for. I mean, it's just so hard to believe that someone at the top of their game could do something so radically in opposition to the life that they had led to that point. I mean, how does someone end up here? How do you get to this point? I mean, these decisions, as we're going to read in a moment, are going to be the downfall of not just Solomon, but of Israel. The Lord didn't sit idly by when this was taking place. He says in verse 9, the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods. But he did not keep what the Lord commanded. Therefore, the Lord said to Solomon, since this has been your practice and you have not kept my covenant, my statutes that I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. Yet for the sake of David, your father, I will not do it in your days, but I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear it away all the kingdom, and I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of David and for the sake of Jerusalem that I've chosen. You ever have those moments when you think, how does somebody get there? You ever have that question run through your mind? I mean, we're now in chapter 11. The 10 chapters that precede this point are all good. Everything is going right. Most of Solomon's story is great. If we were to stop before this story, Solomon would be the example that we could all follow of what it means to follow God and lead well and walk wisely. He would be the guy, but that's not how we remember Solomon, is it? We don't remember Solomon because of his great choices. We don't remember Solomon because he built a temple. We remember Solomon because he had a lot of wives and he made wrong choices. That's his legacy. That's his story. Causes us to wonder, how does someone get there? I've been there so many times. I serve in a leadership capacity where I have to be in the mix when someone makes tragic and epic choices to destroy their life. And I've sat on ringside to people who have sabotaged and destroyed their lives, blown up every part of their lives. And I often find myself asking the question, how did this happen? How do you get there? You know, we're in this season when we had a lot of family time. It's really great. You know, stores start closing down. You know, Thanksgiving, the stores close down for most of the day. And so you actually have to, you know, spend time with your family, you know, face to face, eyeball to eyeball. You know, Christmas will be similar. You know, New Year's will be similar. You'll get time where you do this. And some of you are in families where you play board games or something like that. How many board game families do we have? We've got some, yeah. Every board game family, typically we didn't do it a lot growing up because inevitably we have, you know, somebody in the family who's the flipper, you know, that they get upset and it's done. You know, they're going to end the game for everybody. They're going to take the, you know, we've got one of those in our family. Brady is that in our family. He's like, he's going to take the ball and go home. You know, he's losing. That's just how it's going to be. But many of you played some games over the Thanksgiving season. You know, this is one that we play a lot. We all know the concept of the game. You know, concept of Jenga is we take these blocks out very carefully and we stack them on top. Now, I'm not very good at Jenga because I've got very shaky hands, and so I tend to be very bad at this game. You know, the idea is we try to find, oh, I'm even shakier this service than last service. So, I mean, we find the blocks. With every one of them, every decision we're making, every choice we're making, we know the point of the game is that the tower becomes what? More destabilized, becomes less sure. So that every decision, every block we remove affects the next one. We know that eventually, if I were to keep removing blocks, eventually it becomes so unstable and my hands are so shaky that this would come crashing to the ground. We know that when it crashes, it's not because of one block getting removed. It wasn't the first block, it wasn't the second block or the third block or even the fourth block. It was one block after another after another. And each time we're playing this risky game of will it collapse or not. And every time we come out on the other side of it, oh, we eke out with just another block. We think we've won. We become a little bit more secure in our bad choices, don't we? Because we won that time, didn't we? Didn't fall over. Whew, it almost did, but let me try it again. Right? And we sit back, we wonder how does our life fall apart? How do our decisions affect that? The truth is, our life never falls apart because of one choice, does it? But from a series of choices. And those series of choices, they almost inoculate us. They lull us to sleep into believing that we're safe. But hear me today. You're most vulnerable when you think you're safe. You're most vulnerable when you think you're safe. I mean, think about Solomon for a second. Here's a guy that could not be more safe. He could not be in a better position. He could not have had more going for him. He had wealth, I got it. Wisdom, I got it. Wives, got that. I mean, literally, he's got everything going for him. There is nothing. Influence, I've got it. Power, I've got it. There is nothing. But yet, Solomon is more vulnerable than anyone, despite having more safety than everyone. See, it's because we tend to think that we will see the pit in the ground and just avoid it. But that's just not how it does, is it? I mean, look back at your own choices and look back at your own life. Your life is a series of removing the blocks and removing the bricks. And every time we get down the wrong path, every time we make choices, we are choosing right or wrong, wise or unwise, good or bad. Every time we are doing that, every time we remove a block and go, man, I've got this taken care of. I'm on the top of my game. This thing won't fall down. I've got things in control. I'm okay. Every time you feel safe, you're actually very, very vulnerable because you think that you hold your own world together. That you think that the small, unwise, or even sinful choices that you make won't have that big an effect, because what do we do when we feel safe? When we're in a good space in life, when we got a good headspace, when things are going right, boy, what do? Boy, I can probably handle not reading my Bible today. I've got some other things I need to do, or I can probably push that time of prayer away, or I can get a little distance in some godly relationships, or I tend to let those disciplines fall back because I'm feeling really good. I'm feeling really close to God right now. I'm feeling really connected, despite the fact that you got close to God by staying in the Word and staying in prayer. You stayed in that space, but you know, we do this foolish thing that once we get close, we feel like we can pull the gas off the pedal. We make choices that we think we can handle. We say, well, it's probably not that big of a deal. I mean, there are worse things that people are doing, right? See, the challenge with being safe, like Solomon was safe, is that we tend not to be aware of our own issue, do we? See, he was so confused and so lost, and he didn't even know it. He was so trapped and headed down a pathway, and he was completely unaware. Every choice and every decision, every person that he interacted with, boy, it gets a little bit more dangerous, doesn't it? Gets a little bit tougher to do. But I got this, because I'm the wisest man who's ever lived. See, we fool ourselves. And the way that we end up, if you ask the question, how do people end up where their marriages have fallen apart? Or how do they end up where they're having an affair? Or how do they end up with catastrophic financial loss? Or how do they end up making these terrible sinful? I mean, how do we get there? You don't get there overnight. You don't get there with one choice. You get there with the sum of all your choices that have led you down a path. And every time that you take another choice, you are removing another brick, and it becomes harder and more dangerous every single time. And every time you cheat, the thing falling apart, that pride grows. See, your decisions take you into a direction Your decisions shape not just where you are, but who you are. They make you who you are. The challenge is that we don't really notice them, do we? I mean, all the wealth and all this stuff, we just don't even notice. It's like the old kid story, the frog and the pot, right? Put a frog into a boiling pot of water, he's going to jump out. Put a frog into a pot of water and then slowly turn on the burner. They'll cook themselves because their body is slowly adjusting to the danger that is around them. And for you and for me, it's all the same. Solomon's choices began so many years earlier. He didn't even know at the time how dangerous this decision was. When he first gets the chance to meet with God, where God wakes him up in that dream and gives him that supernatural wisdom, there are two things that have already taken place at the beginning of his reign when he's 20 years old trying to figure things out that will set the trajectory and the course of everything he's going to do that will lead to failure. The first thing he does is to do something that on its face is not a wrong choice. It was not forbidden in the law. He could marry an Egyptian woman. That was not forbidden in the law. And then he worships God in a high place. I mean, the justification was, well, there was no temple built, right? There wasn't. So let's just use the temple that's already here. Sure, it's dedicated to the other God, but I mean, we're not worshiping them. We're worshiping God, Yahweh. We're not worshiping the true God. And so we're not worried about that. I mean, it'll be okay this time. But those decisions set a trajectory. And it's amazing how many times our unwise choices morph into dramatically sinful choices. That what starts out as something that's just stupid ends up being something that is sinful. And had Solomon looked down the road, had Solomon taken a beat, had Solomon taken a breath and said, God, what would you want me to do? Is this the wise thing to do? What will this lead to? Solomon, boy, it could have changed his life and changed his story. You see, we never realize the dramatic effect of our choices until it's all fallen apart. No matter how shaky things get, until it's all fallen down. But it wasn't just his choices. See, your choices not only shape where you are, but they shape who you are, but something else shaped Solomon. Something we've made light of, but it was certainly significant. That Solomon had entered into literally 1,000 relationships that turned his heart away from God. See, our relationships are another factor. So our choices shape where we are and who we are, but our relationships also shape who we are, don't they? So Solomon, despite the warning of Scripture, despite the warning of God to say, listen, Solomon, you get into a relationship with the Hittites and you get into a relationship with the Ammonites and the Moabites and all these other nations that surround you, you will have your heart pulled away from God. The people who speak into your life, the people who give you advice, the people who are leading you and influencing you will affect you and shape you. They will make you who you are. And sometimes we think, well, I got this one friend, he's kind of an idiot, but I kind of keep him around, right? Everybody's got a one friend that's an idiot, right? Okay, maybe I'm that friend for you guys, I don't know, but I'm like, yep, everybody does. This guy, you know, like, but so everybody's got that one person that we try to pull up, we're trying to pull into our world, but yet they're giving us insight and they're giving us advice, we're giving them space in our heart, they're giving them space in our life, and we think that it does not affect us anymore. And really, we have two kinds of friends in our life. We have those that lift us up and those that weigh us down. Those that lift us up and encourage us and spur us on and are willing to get into our world, and those that weigh us down. And you can carry those that weigh you down for a little while, but eventually you will get tired. And they will weigh you down, but more importantly, they will pull you down. See, what we learn from Solomon's life in a very tragic way is that our relationships matter. Solomon gets into these relationships, and the warning was, Solomon, don't do that. Why? Not because God doesn't like marriage, not because that polygamy was illegal, because it wasn't. It's because They will turn your heart. It's inevitable, Solomon. They're going in different directions. I didn't say this in first service, but let me say this to all of you who are single in this room, looking to, you know, someday get married. Listen, who you marry matters. This is why the Bible talks about not being unequally yoked, because you cannot marry someone who does not follow God and expect that you will end up following God. They're going in a different direction than you. That's why Solomon gets such an important voice. So your friends, your relationships, those who will let you allow to speak into your life. I'm not talking about not having friends with those who are not saved. All this. You need those relationships. I'm talking about the people who are speaking into your life. Those people need to be godly people. You know why? It's because the scripture teaches it. You know what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15? He says, do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Bad company corrupts good character. What Paul rightly realizes is that if you surround yourself with people who are not godly, they are leading you somewhere. They are influencing you somewhere. That if you do not surround yourself, the people that are closest to you, with people who are going to speak life and truth into you, you will find yourself in a place of destruction, because our relationships shape who we are. They shape who we are. And some of you are sitting here knowing that you've got relationships in your life that are the reason why you struggle. They are the reason why you find yourself consistently in a place of pain. The challenge for us is that our choices and our relationships shape who we are. They shape where we end up. See, Solomon, he couldn't complain about where he was. He couldn't even be surprised by it, could he? Because after all, relationship after relationship and choice after choice had led him to the place where it all came crashing down. And all the things that he put stock in, all the things that he never thought he would do, this is the man who just built the temple is now worshiping foreign gods in high places all over Jerusalem. You know, he put all his trust in all these things, and this is the nature of total destruction that we see, is that those things inevitably turn on him. When the people of, when God takes the kingdom from him, all of a sudden, the allies that he had made through these marriages began to turn on him. The Pharaoh in Egypt begins to ally with one of Solomon's enemies, and the enemies begin to crop up, and things, there's all this turmoil and all this difficulty. In Solomon's reign, the last 20 years of his life, he ruled for 40 years, the last 20 years are full of pain and difficulty and conflict and challenge. They're full of all of that. That is how he ends his story. That is how he ends his life. That's it. Because you put his trust in things that do not and cannot bear the weight of his trust. Now, there may be people here today who you realize that you are in that place where you've made choices. And your Jenga tower is wobbly. For someone first service, call it the Jenga test, right? So you have made a series of decisions, you've made a series of choices, and if you were to evaluate, and because of your relationships, because of your choices, boy, you feel unstable right now. You feel shaky right now. That doesn't have to be in every area of your life. Often, many of us we're really solid in some areas and really shaky in others. And the challenge is you feel shaky because you've allowed relationships to get in your life, you've allowed choices to lead you to a place, and you've allowed your own pride to lull you to sleep and realize that you fooled yourself into believing that you're safe when really actually very vulnerable. But right now, you're sitting there going, wait a second. And it becomes difficult because it goes, where do I go from here, right? I don't want to end up in Solomon, and we really don't have anything from the pages of this story that gives us the bright future. Boy, I wish this story had the happily ever after. This story ends with, and Solomon went the way of his fathers, which means that Solomon died. in failure. But the cool thing is this, this is not the end of the story, right? No matter where you are, no matter what your situation is, it's the story of Jesus Christ that no matter how far you are down the path, no matter how wobbly your tower is, Jesus can come and rescue us at any point where we're at. That is the hope of Jesus Christ. I mean, if you look at the pages of the gospel, if you look at the pages of scripture, Jesus is in the business. That is what he does. That is what he specializes in. Whether it's Mary Magdalene, the prostitute. I mean, you don't come to a place where you're a prostitute thinking that's got a lot of upward mobility, right? Zacchaeus, the tax collector, the guy who's hated by everybody in his culture. I mean, literally one after the other, Jesus is grabbing hold of the woman, the Samaritan woman by the well, and saying, I mean, this is a woman who has had five marriages, and she's living with another guy. I mean, she is in bad shape, and then she walks away from a conversation with Jesus, having started a new journey. It is all predicated on this one word. In fact, if you were to look through the New Testament, especially if you read through the book of Acts, this is the thing that the New Testament preachers preach about probably the most. That if you get to the climax of their sermon, this word will find its place. It's this Bible word, this church word, repent. Repent. Now, some of us start to bristle when we hear the word repent, because our culture has said to us and fed us a lie that we're okay the way we are. But that's not true, is it? We're not okay the way we are. We're okay when we're on a trajectory toward Jesus. But you know what that little word repent, there's a couple of different Greek words that are used to use this word, but that little word repent really is very simple. It means to turn. It means to turn. That when we repent, what we're doing is we're leaving our path and we're turning around and we're walking on God's. That no matter where you are on your path, there's always a place where you can turn toward God. No matter what relationships that have you gotten entangled with, there's always a space where you can turn toward God. There's always an opportunity. But when we cry out to Jesus and say, Jesus, I need help. My tower is not stable. My choices and my relationships have led me to this place, and I see down the road that this is going to crash. This path leads to pain. This path leads to destruction. Man, Jesus, he gives us, no matter where we are in the path, we get the opportunity to turn and start a new path with Jesus. Jesus gives us the chance. No matter where you are, no matter what it is, there is no spot in your journey where you can't have another opportunity to start over. The great news of the kingdom of God is it's never too late for a second chance. I don't care what your story is. I don't care how far gone your marriage is. I don't care what the situation may be. Listen, it's never too late for Jesus to change your path. Whether you are at the start, or whether you are in the middle, or whether you have fallen apart, Jesus is there to start you on a new path. Let's pray together. Lord, we come to you today and certainly feel the soberness of this passage. This passage in your love and your kindness stands as the warning, the big warning light on our dashboard to say, hey, listen, that our choices and the people we come into relationship with matter. That what we do and who we align with determines who we become. And Jesus, I know that each one of us has choices and decisions, situations in our life where things are a little more wobbly. Some people may be at the place of disaster. Some people may be just at the mouth of the trail. No matter where we are, you give us the power. It's not a power that we possess on our own. It's not a power that we can conjure up, but you give us the ability to turn. When we see you for who you are and what you've done, we have the capacity to look to you instead of to our own destructive choices, our own ideas, our own relationships, voices that are in our life. We look to you and your voice in our life. And we turn. We turn. And we submit to your leadership in our life. Because your plan for us is better. Your path for us is better. And it ends not in death, not in destruction, not in pain. It ends in life. So God, we turn. God, I pray for this moment that you will shine the light into our hearts, that you will shake us and show us the areas that we don't like to look at, but nevertheless that can cause our failure and our destruction, that can cause us great pain, that you will shake us so to the point that we look and see, whether it's with our parenting, our children, or relationships, or our finances, or our personal life, or whatever it may be, whatever sphere of life it may be in, God, that you will shake that loose out of us, that we would leave the dangerous path and turn toward yours. We know that comes through submitting our heart to you and giving you control of our life. In the next few minutes, I'm going to ask you to turn your attention into your heart. Every one of us have areas where the tower is a little shakier. Some of you may have, really are in that place where it's like the blocks have all fallen down. It feels like all hope is lost or whatever it may be. The solution is to turn. For some of you, it's going to be looking at your choices. Some of you, it's going to be looking at your relationships because you've got people in your mind that you know can't have the influence that you've allowed them to have in your life. And you've got to distance yourself from that. Challenge is never knowing really what's right or wrong to do. Turning to Jesus is always right, and we know that in our head. The challenge is the courage to be able to walk faithfully and endure some pain to end up in a space where God gives us life. To look in those areas of our heart. And maybe you're here today and you've never had this turn moment. You've never had this moment of repentance. You've never had this moment where you've left your life and started a life with Jesus. Today can be that day. This is the life of Christ, that we turn away from our sin. We turn away from our choices. We turn away from all the things that come with it, and we turn toward Christ. And he becomes in charge of our journey and our path. Today can be a day, can be the day, when you turn for the very first time and follow Jesus. It doesn't have to come through big, fancy words. It doesn't have to be eloquent. It doesn't need to be authentic. It doesn't need to come from your heart. But you just talk to Jesus and say, Jesus, I know the way I've been doing it, it's not right. But I want to turn today towards you and make you the leader of my life. So you can use this time to talk with him. In a moment, we're going to pray together and ask God to help us. Use this time to talk to Jesus about what's impacted your heart this morning.